We're here at ITU Telecom World 2016 in Bangkok, Thailand, and I've got the great pleasure of being in the studio today with Dr. Hamadoun Touré, former ITU Secretary General and now Executive Director of the Smart Africa Alliance. Dr. Touré, thank you very much indeed for being with us today.
Good to be here again.
Now, we've put this in here just to give you a little bit of branding here, but I want you to tell us a little bit about the Smart Africa Alliance, what it's all about, and tell us what's its vision.
Well, the African continent is decided to move forward using ICT as a tool to meet the not only the Millennium Development Goals, but the Sustainable Development Goals as well. And the creation of Smart Africa is a perfect timing, because when we're reaching 1 billion citizens in Africa, we want them not to be just simple consumers. We want them to be producers. If we want them to be connected, we will need millions of tablets, of smartphones, of computers. And we have to develop hundreds of thousands of applications. And we want Africa to be part and parcel of the production chain of all of these. Smart Africa has been created based on the Smart Africa Manifesto, that is putting private sector first. The partnership with private sector will be key. After putting the right policy and regulatory environment, private sector has to come and invest. And we have a number of private companies that are now members of the alliance, in addition to the governments. And therefore, we hope to build a much greater alliance to make sure that ICT is on the top of the agenda of every nation. Now, every country joining the alliance has a flagship program that it develops. Therefore, we don't want to leave anybody behind. We want to make sure that everyone is contributing to the best of their capabilities, and then they're sharing back the experience with other countries so that we all go fast together. So it's the organization is at its beginning, but there is a real momentum. I believe there's a perfect, the timing was simply perfect.
In terms of collaboration within Smart Africa, what are the challenges and what are the benefits?
Some of the key challenges are first to put the ICT policy framework in place to be able to attract industry, because we know the industry is ready. We know the need is there. There are many countries who believe in it now. And the next challenge after that is to make to put in place the right capacity building and education programs that will train the people at the right time. What we want to achieve here is job creation. We have a large population of youth. We have over 300 million young people. Majority of them are finishing university, and we need to make sure that they're not going to cross the Mediterranean by boats. We want them to stay in Africa and work. Therefore, in order to prepare them to be developing applications, services that they can use home and work and produce, and really not be attempted by unnecessary immigration, we believe that planning gives an opportunity, because ICT is a cross-cutting industry. It has an impact for agriculture, commerce, transport, or smart cities. Whatever part of the industry you take for the development, ICT will have a key role in it. And our young people, who believe that they are very innovative, it's a matter of finding the right opportunity to be given to them so that they can really express themselves, be competitive on the world market as well, and really contribute to the development of the continent.
Now, Smart Africa was founded in Rwanda, which has a very active tech, SME and entrepreneur culture. I wanted to ask you, what factors do you think have contributed in making it successful, and how has government policy supported the SMEs there?
Rwanda is probably one of the most forward-looking countries in the world, actually, in terms of putting the right policy framework to attract industry and to attract small and medium enterprises. I'll give you an example. When I arrived on January 7 in Kigali, we were creating this company from scratch. And it took me less than 6 hours to be in an office and operational. It takes today 3 to 5 hours to create a company in Rwanda. I think that's one of the number ones in the world, and therefore the credit should be given to the leadership there. President Kagame, who is the chairman of the board of Smart Africa, is injecting style in the work of Smart Africa to make sure that we are business oriented, creating opportunity for young entrepreneurs. There is a small laboratory in Rwanda called K-Lab that is an incubator for young entrepreneurs. It's an incubator for new applications and new services, and is giving the right opportunity. They're creating a special investment bank to help them. They are finding champions and advocates who would be training them. They are finding companies that will be sponsoring those young people from scratch. I mean, those are types of examples that really need to be encouraged. I'm very pleased that ITU, the ITU new Secretary General, Mr. Zhao, has put the SMEs at the top of his agenda. It's the right approach because more than half of the young people who are employed by SMEs, and therefore we need to give them the right opportunity to blossom. There are a few challenges. First, you have to have the right policy and a regulatory environment. Second, the risk-taking culture for SMEs is also a real important factor. Especially, it's a factor that is a problem in many countries in Africa. Some, by nature, don't want to take risk because they're afraid of failure. And we need to change that mindset. I mean, success comes out of multiple failures. And some countries understood that, and they are really succeeding. Once you break that barrier of taking risks, therefore you need to then find the right financing model to help support them. Most of the times they don't need a very large investment, but any investment comes with some risk, and therefore you need to find that, and some countries are putting that in the right structure in place for that.
If you had to identify a single factor, what would that be?
Oh, growth of digital economy is all based on partnership, government and private sector. I mean, the PPP model is very important, especially when governments are at the stage of takeoff. They need to set the right policy and regulatory framework. Now, once that there, private sector has to come in. So the two have to work together. And you need to overcome some of the myth around Africa. There is a lot of talk about corruption. There is corruption everywhere in the world. Of course, you cannot take off with corruption. But there are many leaders in the continent who are making sure that they do have a clean environment where people can operate. And I'm inviting all the investors to come in and see in those countries where it works, then they can work. And also countries will follow. Therefore, I think that the opportunity is there. And I am very confident that Africa is at the perfect time of its new development using ICT. This fourth industrial revolution will not miss that. I can assure you that there is a confidence. Not only the time is ripe, because we have 1 billion citizens, 1 billion consumers. Now, if you put the right regulatory and policy environment there, investment will flow. And the message has been clear. Come and invest in Africa and make profits out of it. There's nothing wrong with making profits. It's not a crime. And I know when private sector is making profits, they will invest. And they will not take away the profit. They will reinvest it and make more profits. That's the rules of the game. And we know well that you cannot be rich with your own money. You can only be rich with other people's money. So we are inviting everyone to come and work with us in a win-win model that, so that we can really work together. Now, I want to make sure that in the process, will have a conceived in Africa model, will have a made in Africa concept that will enable us to also be part of the manufacturing chain and the conceptual chain, so that our young people be innovative. We're going to help them in ensuring that they have also the right intellectual property rights in training in that model and the protection in that, so that they can really start sharing information and still benefit from their discoveries or their inventions and their innovations.
Why it's important and what is it of value nowadays to be attending ITU Telecom World?
Well, I'm very happy to see ITU Telecom World growing bigger and bigger every year. It shows the importance of ITU. It shows the importance of the industry ITU is dealing with, bringing the telecommunication sector, the service providers, and also the the over-the-top players who are now joining forces, because there was long battle between the two communities. Now there's a clear understanding that the two communities need to work together and in a win-win mode, and that's really very pleasant. I'm pleased to see, it's an opportunity also to see the many ministers and policymakers who come here with industry leaders. Therefore, it is a perfect environment to share ideas on and strategies on how to move forward, how to develop this industry that is now the key tool for all the sectors of the industry. We're talking about sustainable development goals. It will never happen without ICT, and everyone understands that. And the partnership, the sharing of information, ITU is really the place to come and share information.
Well, Dr. Hamid Ansari, thank you very much for taking the time to come and talk to us in the studio today. We very much appreciate it.
My pleasure.
And we wish you all the very best with Smart Africa.
Thank you.